Hello and good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Thorsten Hülsmann. I'm the Chief Financial Officer of International Data Spaces Association, and I welcome you warmly to this fifth edition of the Data Spaces Dialogue. And we are talking on design principles for European data spaces. And as it is 11 sharp right now, and I see that more participants are joining, let us wait one, two more minutes until everyone has the possibility to go through the introduction ceremony by GoToWebinar, and then we can start in 1-2 minutes. For those of you who are new in this Data Spaces Dialogue, we started this endeavor and these live sessions last year and wanted to inform and wanted to give the voice to organizations and to people who are joining the Data Spaces community. The Data Spaces community is not only from International Data Spaces Association, but also from other organizations who are interested in sovereign data sharing, because this is basically the reason why data spaces are discussed and are implemented in various B2B data sharing environments. So this is what we have done last year. We started the first Data Spaces Dialogue with the chairman of the board, Dr. Reinhold Achatz from ThyssenKrupp, and my colleague Lars Nagel. It was already in summer or autumn last year. And then we discussed several topics on design principles for data spaces. And today I'm very glad that, yes, we have two representatives of Spanish organization. This is first Oscar Lazaro from Innovalia Association. Welcome, Oscar, and thank you that you join us for this hour today. And second, it is Daniel Sáez Domingo from Valencia, from ITI Institute. We will learn in a minute more about these two organizations. And yes, what we are discussing today is mainly the engagement from various Spanish organizations, from Spanish communities, from regional networks, maybe also from domain networks and projects. Because Spain, as everyone knows, is a very interesting market. We have very interesting companies, both from the side of data providers, so manufacturing companies, very reputed ones, which have a very important role in the value chain, but also very reputed IT and software companies, which are, implementing various services and technologies on data sharing. And finally, also a very interesting research and innovation scene. And this is also the reason why we have today these two renowned speakers. So I think now we have almost 60 people in the session, and I think we can slowly start. I still see that people joining, but we cannot lose time, so we will start right now. So again, everyone who is here in the live session listening, my name is Thorsten Hülsmann, CFO of International Data Spaces Association, and I'm moderating these Data Spaces Dialogue. What we are doing is we are listening and we are debating on design principles for European data spaces. And this is the fifth edition today, focusing on the perspective from two Spanish institutes and associations. And this is what we will do in the next 60 minutes. So as I already said, data spaces are quite new. I mean, International Data Spaces Association is existing since 2016, so already in the fifth year. But as we started 5 years ago, these data spaces topic was quite new. What is this, it is about is that data spaces are a way to sovereignly share data in B2B environments, and usually these data spaces are peer-to-peer networks. So it's a slightly different differentiation from data markets or pure data portals. Of course, portals and markets could be part of data spaces, but data spaces as such are peer-to-peer networks. So now we want to introduce our two speakers. And first, Oscar Lazaro is Managing Director of Innovalia Association. And Oscar, I would like to ask you, as Innovalia is also the IDSA hub facilitator in Spain, that you please introduce yourself, your organization, and maybe also a little bit the history and the development of the IDSA hub in Spain so far.
Thank you, Thorsten, and let me go very very quickly and take just a couple of minutes to introduce to you who we are and why we engage in this big endeavor that is the International Data Space Association. Innovalia Association is a private associated research laboratory that is based in the Basque Country, and we are basically dealing with two types of business, the digital business and the Industry 4.0 business. So we have two business units, one dealing with the smart city digital market, and the second one dealing with the Industry 4.0 market that is more concretely addressing the issue of quality control, where our products and technology lies. Innovalia Association is basically this associated research unit that is making sure that the products, solutions and services that we deliver to the market are really up to the newest trends and the highest standards. And that is why we decided some time ago to make a strategic decision to support the issue of data sharing in the B2B environment with this ambition of developing and becoming part of industrial data spaces. As Thorsten was mentioning, Innovalia is actually the facilitator of the IDSA activities in Spain. There are already other entities, private, public and research institutions that engage in the IDSA activities in Spain from an early stage. You can see that in the slides, which are the main research centers in Spain. But not only that, also companies of the size of Atos are supporting activities from day one. And we early kickoff activities of the hub in December 2019. With support from various institutions, from the European level, from obviously from the IDSA office itself, but also from the regional and local government, and engaging a global activity from the hub in connection with the World Economic Forum. So the activities of the hub are really of a global nature. However, as we have all had to face during 2020, we had to basically manage the impact of COVID in the plans that we had. In any case, what we are aiming at as a community is really to support in shaping the future of our national data economy. So I am really sure that you will not only learn about the International Data Space Association today, you will also learn about the impact and the strategies behind the development of the data economy in Spain, since this is one of the major pillars in the recovery plans that the whole industry, not only the digital, but the different verticals have to put together in the next 4 or 5 years to recover from the impact that COVID has had on our activities. So behind these activities of the hub is really to foster the development of this smart ecosystem, common data spaces and digital value chains. And this is something that obviously not us, but any industry alone cannot realize, and that is why we need a community and we need this type of facilitation at the Spanish level. And now that we are regaining activity and we hope to engage in more active participation of the different stakeholders during 2021, creating this and developing these common data spaces, what we are inviting is all stakeholders, industry, government, universities, to engage with us in this multi-sectorial, transversal and open approach that we are putting together with the support of the IDSA Hub Spain, that is playing this facilitating role, making sure that the knowledge, the activities and the initiatives are transferred and connected with the European and the global dimension of the international data space scope, with the final aim to make sure that our national or regional local data spaces as a community scale up, interoperate and engage in future digital value chains.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Oscar, for this comprehensive introduction of Innovalia, of the IDSA Hub in Spain. And yes, I think now we can travel from Bilbao to Valencia, because Daniel from ITI, I mean, we know each other also since a couple of years already, even though ITI is not or joined only recently, last year or the end of 2019, I think, the association. Daniel, would you mind to introduce your institute, and maybe you could already relate a little bit your activities to this topic of data spaces and sovereign data sharing, because what you have already done is you engaged together with IDSA in the one or the other important research projects or innovation projects, and maybe you could also relate already to some projects and endeavors what you have which you have started in Spain. So please.
Okay, thank you very much, Thorsten, and thank you very much for inviting ITI to show what we are doing regarding especially data spaces and big data and artificial intelligence in general. Maybe you know some about us, but just a brief introduction to ITI. We are a technology center in Spain with around 250 people working, as I will say later, around data cycle, which is our main focus. Our work is focused on oriented research. I mean, we are always listening to the needs of the market, and we do research and innovation in digital technologies to transfer these technologies to companies and to the market in order to make more competitive to this market, to this technological ecosystem around us. We are also an association of companies with more than 240 companies. Most of them are ICT companies. So we have a very good ecosystem in order to provide services to end users, both through ITI and our ecosystem of technological companies. This is our strategic framework. As I said before, data is in the middle of our strategy, and we develop different activities of research and innovation in different digital enablers like cyber physical systems, cyber connectivity, cloud computing, big data, artificial intelligence, following all the data cycle from data gathering, communications, storage and processing, simulation, big data analytics and so on. And always with different horizontal layers, talking about software engineering, cyber security, quality of software, resilient systems that are giving quality to all our developments. Regarding the theme we are talking today, we are a strategic position in several initiatives at European, national and regional levels. In one side, at the European level, we are founding members of BDBA since 2014. We are also members of IDSA for sure, and also we are day one members of Gaia-X, which for us are three key initiatives in this aspect related to data spaces. At the Spanish level, we are member of Planetic, and I will elaborate a bit more what we are doing in Planetic regarding data spaces. And at the regional level, we are also a DIH, and we have the Data Cycle Hub, which is we can say the ITI data digital innovation hub. And we are also coordinating Andromeda Digital, which is the candidate of the Valencia region for the European DIHs network, which is now on process of launching the call. So we are, in this case, providing services at regional level, services of data and data analysis and so on. And finally, we are also coordinating the EU Hubs for Data project, which is another very important project in this European Common Data Spaces arena. And I will tell a bit more about this project later on. But in a nutshell, it is combining both levels, European level and regional level. So we can talk a bit more later. So for the introduction, it is okay.
Perfect. Thank you. Thank you very much. But I think I was already curious by this project Planetic, because obviously it is not a European one. I only found Spanish information on it. So unfortunately, you just have to go through and focus maybe a little bit on the Planetic project. So please explain us what is in there and how is it related to the topic of sovereign data sharing or data spaces.
Okay. Planetic is the Spanish technological platform for data services, embedded systems, nanotechnologies. Well, it is a kind of merge between the software part, the embedded software part, and the intelligent systems like Excel was at European level. Well, Excel is not a technology platform, but more or less, these are the areas that are covered by Planetic. And we are structured in different working groups, and one of them is talking about big data and artificial intelligence. In this group, we have done different position papers or white papers in the past, talking about what is the critical mass in Spain for big data analytics or for artificial intelligence. And now in Spain, there is a lot of movement and there is a lot of enthusiasm regarding data spaces, especially because of the recovery funds that are also focusing on this data economy. So we understood from Planetic that we need to make a position paper or our position from Planetic to explain what a data space is, because there are a lot of initiatives talking about data exploitation, data experimentation, and others are talking about data spaces, different areas of application of these data spaces, but maybe there is not a clear vision of what a data space is. And both from the users, but also from the public administration, which is the responsible of leverage and reinforce these initiatives with these funds, these recovery funds. So we are trying to make our position from Planetic regarding data spaces. This is a typical description of a data space, which Thorsten mentions before a little bit. We are talking about the structures that provide trust and security for sharing data in a voluntary basis. And then we need to address different challenges like the data governance, the organizational issues, legal and technical issues or mechanisms, to provide interoperability of data and also data services, assuring the sovereignty of data from of the owners of the data. So this is the book definition of a data space, but we need we wanted to share this definition with a group of technology platforms led by Planetic, and we did this in this inter-platform initiative, which is the inter-platform initiative of big data and artificial intelligence in space in Spain. This is a very interesting group because we have 13 vertical platforms, which are also mirrors of other European platforms, but in at the Spanish level, for example, health sector, manufacturing sector, logistics and mobility, water, which is very important for Spain, food, tourism, biotechnology. We have a very very rich ecosystem of users and also providers of data. And we also have different horizontal platforms. One of them is Planetic, but we have others in the group, like Ametic, or also the security platform, or other platform more focused on science, and also two networks for representing the infrastructures, which is the Spanish network of supercomputing and the big data excellence network in Spain. And we have the support of the different ministries in Spain, and also the standardization body, which is UNE, which is also supporting this initiative. So we have a lot of ingredients here to discuss about what a data space is and in which sectors we have more critical mass and more tools in order to deploy these data spaces and make it a reality. We have some use cases and some prototypes, but we need to go in detail, go ahead. So we are asking in this group, we know and we understand the power of data for creating the data economy. This is not under question, but how to measure the impact, which are the incentives for a company to put data, to share data with others, why the lack of trust that we perceive in companies when they need to share data, how can the data be interoperable, or is there any standard in order to make clear rules for data sharing? These are questions that we are asking in this position paper, and we are trying to answer. To answer, we first are reviewing and the policy framework for data spaces in Spain. We think we have a very very good framework in Spain, because we have first a research and innovation agenda for artificial intelligence, which is talking about data, of course, for doing this research. More recently, we have the Spanish strategy for the digital Spanish strategy for 2025, which is talking about the data economy as one of the pillars, and also the artificial intelligence strategy for Spain, following the European strategy, which is also talking about the needs of data spaces in order to provide data to the algorithms of artificial intelligence. And more recently, we have the plans for recovery in Europe, which are giving more power, more budget in order to put in practice some of the initiatives. So we have a favorable framework at this moment, but we need to clarify what the initiatives we can follow, or what building blocks we have already available in order to make these data spaces a reality. In this paper, we are focusing on three main initiatives I mentioned before: International Data Spaces Association for sure, also Gaia-X and Big Data Value Association. For us, are three reference initiatives. which are solving problems like data governance, sovereignty, data infrastructures, how data can be exploited, or how can we experiment with data. Maybe IDSA is talking more about data governance, sovereignty, Gaia-X data infrastructures, and BDBA about exploitation and experimentation with the concept of iSpaces, which I can tell a little bit later. And based on these reference initiatives, we are trying to build Lighthouse data space in Spain, taking into account that Spain has high potential and experience in different sectors, for example, transport, and especially in seaports, also agriculture and food production, health, tourism, or industry for sure. So we are trying to give use cases in this position paper and examples of how in some of these sectors we can build data spaces. And we end with final recommendations for the public administrations in order to push these data spaces in Spain. For example, the building of an advisory committee start and based on the high experience in Spain in different segments, RTOs, universities, companies that can provide some building blocks and some design or architectures for these data spaces. As I mentioned before, try to select lighthouse sectors in order to demonstrate the impact of data spaces in the economy, support SMEs, connect with DIHs and iSpaces in order to improve the experimentation, focus on the skills and technical skills on data analytics and artificial intelligence, but also business models and data monetization, which is very important for creating this data economy. Identify building blocks, reinforce the technological ecosystems around data, because it is important. We need to create a marketplace where technological companies can put services above the data, and increase the communication campaigns about data sharing. These are the final recommendations from Planetic and from this inter-platform group regarding data spaces. I can stop here and maybe we can elaborate a bit more later.
Perfect. Thank you, Daniel. And I think this is, utmost valuable information, because usually we are, discussing all these issues on a European level. And then maybe in my case, I know a little bit about the German-speaking countries, how these uptakes are organized there. So I think this is very valuable information, and also important to compare how the different national uptakes in other countries are taking place, because why should one do things which are maybe already experienced in other countries. So I think this is very valuable information. Thank you, Daniel, for sharing this with us. Oscar, I think when Daniel was mentioning these important topics of infrastructure, maybe we have to distinguish a little bit about the hard infrastructure and what we call the soft or virtual infrastructure. And maybe it's up to you as a representative of the Spanish IDSA Hub facilitator, maybe to go a little bit deeper into this, because I know that you are also involved in some activities about this, and maybe also to make clear what is needed to really come up with trusted activities, or activities which lead to trust, to trusted environments. And there definitely these data infrastructure, whether they are hard infrastructure or soft infrastructure, are needed. Maybe you can comment on this and elaborate it a little bit.
Thank you, Thorsten. I think this issue is probably one that we have to deal from different angles, because I think most of the time we are asking ourselves how to create these data ecosystems, how to provide the required infrastructure to support these type of activities. But if we go back to basics, particularly from where we started a few years back, if we think about the data economy, everything seems to be about data and saving data, but there is something very important, is how you do it, okay? And based on this, there are already, from the path that we have gone through the last 3 years in lighthouse projects, like transforming transport or Boost 4.0, that are really trying to understand not only what are the challenges for selling data, but what are the challenges for using data. So these data economy challenges we can summarize basically in three main barriers that we have to address. The first one is how we can generate this trust. And I think in this particular element of trust, the International Data Space Association has a lot to say. And it is not only that they have a lot to say, it's just that we have evidence that with the International Data Space Association reference architecture and the technologies, we can actually alleviate very significantly this lack of trust. And then we can enable really competitive advantages. But at the same time, it is interoperability and costs. We have to remember that data spaces cannot exist without data. So the cost of bringing data up to the quality that is required to share this data and to make it interoperable with and usable by other stakeholders and partners, members of this data space, is something that should be carefully evaluated and effectively supported. And finally, it is continuity and a controlled free flow of data. So once we have this trust on the environment, when we have the data ready to be shared, is how we can ensure and enforce that all these conditions and agreements that we need to put the data into action to share effectively, this data can actually be articulated. And for this, we have basically to deal with three main issues. We need to break the silos, we need to connect data endpoints, and we need to integrate this in our digital services. And to do so, this is also feeding in and coming out of the study and the position of the Spanish industry with respect to data spaces. What we have understood is that data sharing spaces, common data spaces, start from a change in the business culture. It has to be started from a fundamental analysis on the business needs for development of a strategic industrial value chains that could indicate and could identify what is the value behind data sharing for increasing competitiveness. After that, it is very important to look at the data space assets and governance of those assets from the perspective of common design principles, not trying to bring data silos into data space silos. Sharing these common design principles should ensure that once we have broken the silos to connect our data endpoints, we are not creating meta silos. So it is very important that these design principles are shared, because data spaces will be created in different verticals and within each of the verticals. And to articulate these common design principles is indispensable to have access to global federated trusted cloud and edge, so an infrastructure that is federated and trusted. And this really requires the physical implementation of this infrastructure that should be combined with a soft infrastructure that you were mentioning, Thorsten, that is really related to the certified data services. And I should stress here the word certified. If we want to create trust in sharing and enabling this sovereign access control and usage control on our data assets, it is important not only that the software that we make use of, but the entities that engage in our data sharing activities are actually certified and comply with the rules of the data space. And only with these elements, we can actually boost competitiveness, because this is what we wanted to implement from the very beginning. Only when we have access to this infrastructure, the soft infrastructure for the data space, the data assets in the right form, then we can articulate these AI power services that we know will bring these competitive advantages. So how are we moving forward in terms of creating this momentum to generate these lighthouse data spaces that Danny was mentioning? Basically, we are starting from the strategic industrial value chains. So really the lighthouse projects that will transform European industry in the years to come. And Europe has agreed that there are six strategic industrial value chains that will be heavily invested in the future, including future aspects of mobility, connected clean, autonomous vehicles, smart health, low CO2 emission industry related to the Green Deal and a circular economy, but again connected with the industrial Internet of Things, very much connected to an advanced and intelligent manufacturing 4.0. But we should not forget about the transformation that the energy sector will be subjected to, like transformation in terms of the use of hydrogen technologies, alliances at European scales for the electric batteries, or the change in terms of the use of our smart grids. This all will evolve, revolve, and will be powered by data spaces. So which are these enablers or design principles that we should take into account when we deal with this establishment of soft and hard infrastructure? We need to understand that the development and the deployment of these common and shared data spaces have two dimensions. We have to agree to actually articulate and exploit data sharing two different but complementary dimensions. We need to get industrial agreements and we need to get technical agreements. Only when we put all these dimensions together, we have all the ingredients to succeed in the development of any kind of data space. And this means that the members of the data space will have to agree on the data standards for exchanging information, semantic structures, meaning of data that will be used in the space, agree on the exchange protocols, identification and authentications of the members when they participate in the data space, enable a specific usage control and authorization to make sure that data is only used for the purpose that is intended in such a data space. But on the other hand, it is also very important, since we have to remember that the development of any data space is initiated by a change and a transformation in the business culture, so there is a need for change and transformation at the business model level. The data space is actually an enabler and an instrument to perform a transformation in the way things are done and business is conducted. So it is very important that with this change in the business model, then we also establish the legal agreements and the governance models that will have to be enacted and will have to be enforced by our technical solutions. Because only combining these operational, legal, governance, and business model operations, we can ensure that the value that should be delivered by the technical implementation of the data space can actually be realized. And I think I will stop here.
Thank you, Oscar. Thank you so much for this comprehensive overview. And I think it is also of high importance, and maybe for the listeners only to explain why we have this OpenDI logo here. The OpenDI project is a coordination and support action where Innovalia and also ATOS and IDSA are beneficiaries. And within this OpenDI project, we have organized throughout the last months a task force on on design principles for data sharing, basically. And the result, the preliminary result of this task force is now a position paper, which will be published soon, I think already in 1 or 2 weeks. My colleague Silvia Castelvi has organized this. And if you are interested, you should stay tuned, because I think this paper will contain a lot of those topics Oscar just mentioned. So this is just to explain a little bit the background of this. Thank you, Oscar, so much. And this is also very important. And I want to make, before I hand over again to Daniel, another relation. Maybe you are aware that in the Netherlands, the Dutch AI Coalition has recently published a gap analysis, a paper where, well, a lot of those elements have been compared and evaluated. And I invite everyone just to have a look on this paper. For instance, our colleagues from TNO from the Netherlands can help everyone to get access to it. But you can also just browse in the net or at LinkedIn AI Coalition from the Netherlands gap analysis, because there, especially the reference architecture models of BDVA and IDSA have been evaluated against other environments, and the findings out of these papers are very interesting and are supporting what Oscar just explained. Daniel, back to you. You mentioned that you are also active in the one or the other project which has this topic of sovereign data sharing as the core. You mentioned data ports and also the project EU Apps for Data. Can you explain us either in both projects or on only one how this is done, and what is the finding for the time being, how these elements have been elaborated? Maybe this is of interest. And for the listeners, by the way, this session is recorded. It will be published soon in the IDSA YouTube channel and on our homepage. And I think also the slides will be available just for those who ask in the chat about this. Daniel.
Okay, thank you. Yes, we are, I think from Spain, we are leading some very important initiatives in this data ecosystem, data platforms, data spaces. One of them is this EU Hubs for Data project, which is the European Federation of Data-Driven Innovation Hubs, which is providing a federation of big data, a federation of Europe, in Europe, for big data, cross-border experimentation and innovation, in order to provide a pan-European catalog of data sources and services, which we can call a European data space, peer-to-peer in this case, but trying to deploy the services at local and regional level, taking profit of the DIHs, which are serving the local ecosystem, the local SMEs at regional level. So we are working on this at this European level in order to federate data sources and also federate and make the services interoperable. And this is where we are working in the sovereignty and the interoperability between data and services. And in this project, which is a coordinated project where we have 21 partners, one of them is IDSA. As you know, you are very active on this part. And we have a strategic task related to interoperability among DIHs. And we are talking about service interoperability and also data and data governance and data interoperability. We are following IDS reference model. We have different, this is an evolutive process. We have three open calls, three rounds of experiments with companies. We are at this moment 12 DIHs, which are providing services of data analytics, data exploitation, and so on. We are coordinating the services of the DIHs. And we are also increasing the network of DIHs. DIHs, but those DIHs are providing services to companies directly through open calls. We have now closed the first open call with 10 experiments, and we will have two more in the future. And we are at this moment we have a set of data sources which are more or less interoperable, but we need to improve this interoperability by deploying this IDS reference model. And we are also contributing and working on the Data Governance Act and Data Act, which is another initiative that is providing this key reference for data sharing and data sovereignty. So in a nutshell, we are following IDS reference model, and we think IDSA is doing a very good work in this, and we trust in this approach at this moment. Regarding another project that you mentioned, Thorsten, we are working and we are also coordinating from ITI, from Spain, data ports project, which is focused on one of the sectors where Spain has a critical mass. This is an industrial data platform, which is dealing with transport information regarding goods and also transport means, where we are deploying different use cases, one in Spain in the Valencia port and another one in Greece in the Thessaloniki port. In the case of Valencia, we are working with this kind of stakeholders in the use case. We have the Valencia Port Foundation, which is a data provider and integrator, ProDevelop, which is a data provider, also integrator and developer, UPB, which is integrator and developer, TransTraxSense, which provides smart assets, data, and also is a service provider, ITI, which is our role of integrator and developer, Everidge, also providing blockchain tools in order to secure and make the reliability of sharing of data, and finally Visual Trans, which is acting as third party, also as data provider and integrator. The flow of data more or less is this one. We have terminal operators and also container carriers which are data providers in this case, which are deploying IDS connectors to connect with the port authority, which is a data consumer and also has a set of data services in order to work with this data. And finally, we have another connector with the IT provider, which is also providing cognitive services, which can make the traditional ports or can transform the traditional ports in cognitive ports or intelligent ports in the future. All this is covered by a data governance layer, where we are establishing, following IDSA model again, the governance and the interoperability of data and services. This is in the right side. You can see more information about some of the services we are providing in the project. But in a nutshell, we can share data and documents among different entities in a secure way, in a trusted environment. We can ensure the data transactions. We can make available the legal documents in digital format, digital asset locations, and better prediction and also anticipation to the events occurrence, for example, the time of arrival of lorries to the port. So these are two examples of projects where we are dealing with data sovereignty, data spaces, data sharing, and there are more. There are another projects led by Spain, and this is for highlighting that Spain is not a follower in this running process. We are also leading some of the projects that are putting some models, some reference pieces for this data spaces. For example, Boost 4.0 that Oscar mentioned before, and which is coordinated by them, but Innovalia, Quality, Zero Defects, manufacturing platforms, Kraken, DMS Accelerator, or Transforming Transport, what that was mentioned before as well. So we are and we have a good environment in Spain to lead and contribute to lead the generation of European common data spaces, also and always taking into account the European initiatives like IDSA, GAIA-X, and BDBA.
Thank you, Daniel, for this comprehensive overview, and also to showcase these two very important projects or use cases, EUApps for Data and Dataports. So I think it's also interesting because the EUApps for Data is offering experimentation environments, from my understanding, where companies could, for instance, align and use these environments for their AI activities. Is this right? So because this data space is slightly different than a pure B2B data in motion environment. Is it right how I understand this?
Yes, you are completely right. For extract value from data, we need the data, as Oscar said before. But we in some point we need to group the data and compose the data lake in order to apply the algorithms in order to extract value from data. So this is the concept of the data innovation spaces we call, and which are also related to the iSpaces concept, which is defined by BDBA. And an iSpace or a data innovation space is a place where we have infrastructures that can store data and also can deploy the tools in order to extract value from data, to exploit the data. So we have different connectors with data owners, data platforms, and data spaces, and we need, in this case, the agreement in order to make this data collection, data gathering in a secure way, in keeping the sovereignty of data. And we also can federate the infrastructure with other infrastructures. But in a nutshell, what we are providing for EUHAS for data is an innovation space like this. It's an innovation space where we can get data from different users, from different experiments, and we can provide support to the experiments. I mean, a company that has a service or an idea of a service that want to use some deep learning technologies to extract value from, for example, manufacturing data. We can get the data from a manufacturing company, and we can put the data together here in this infrastructure where the company can deploy the experiment and test this experiment. This is for sure one of the key services that a DIH can need to provide, which is the test before invest.
Yeah, so thank you, Daniel, for this explanation. And I think it's also valuable because there are so many concepts flying around. And I think it's also important to understand this. You mentioned the different other activities like GAIA-X, for instance, and we have to understand that an iSpace has a different role as an IDS hub, which is more facilitating a community in a country, an iSpace, like you explained before, and the GAIA-X hubs also have more a third meaning. And I think your explanation is very important to understand this. Thank you for this. Oscar, time is running. We only have some 7 minutes left, but I want to ask you to explain us a little bit about one thing you mentioned at the very beginning in the introduction. You also said that data spaces and the sovereign data sharing topics are important for the, let's say, the improvement of resilience of industry. And I know that because we are both engaged in one other project, which is called Eureka, that we are trying to elaborate and investigate how this resilience can be can be pushed forward by sovereign data sharing environments. Maybe you want to share with us also some words and some minutes about this topic.
Yep. So if I can share my screen somehow. Yep. Okay. So let me go here and I think something that you were mentioning, Thorsten, that is very important is the reason why we engage in the development of these common data spaces. And linking to the previous dialogue that we have, it is important to understand what is the value behind establishing this data space. So so far there is this culture that I would say it is quite well established now, and the value of investing in this type of activities is quite well agreed. That is basically the use of big data to improve internal factory processes or to use open data in some other context. But then to look for this business incentive in terms of common data space development, it is something harder, and there is still a lot of work to do in that direction. But if something good has come out, if something good has come out of this COVID-19 situation, is actually the evidence that joining forces, sharing data, sharing knowledge, and collaborating, we can actually implement and respond effectively to the challenges that this type of disruption has impacted our global manufacturing chains. And that is basically the main motivation that is driven behind this initiative that you mentioned, that is Eureka. How we can actually coordinate and improve our preparedness to respond to global manufacturing disruptions. And this could be created by pandemic situations like COVID, but there are many other sources of disruption to global manufacturing. And one of the key elements to improve the preparedness and to accelerate the response to an unexpected event is actually the capability to engage in collaboration and data sharing, so we can improve our performance in terms of the supplier network that is actually providing us with the goods or is delivering the goods to our customers, and also in terms of collaboration between cross-manufacturing networks. With this Eureka project, what we are basically setting up across Europe are the foundation for this type of community. And this is not starting from zero. It is actually building on the lessons that we have already learned over the last 3 years in the development of this European industrial data space that we all together built in this Boost 4.0 initiative. The Boost 4.0 project 3 years ago was an impressive, and I think the partnership, it is impressive itself by the size and the representativeness of the communities, the factories, and the digital players that joined forces. But after 3 years, it was not just a lighthouse project that we had. We managed to coordinate and engage all these assets into a federation of data 4.0 space ecosystems. Actually, with Boost 4.0, we have provided the first evidence that actually bringing together this data ecosystem with the infrastructure ecosystem that we are aiming at putting together with initiatives like Gaia-X or IDSA, we can deliver true value to industry. And this is not just numbers or goodwill or estimations. These are the numbers that have been delivered by the development of these big data and common data space solutions, really bringing competitiveness 4.0 to new levels. We are talking about significant and very impactful improvement in different process performance. And what we have been able to evidence through the implementation of this type of ecosystem is that the use of common and shared data spaces will have and can have an impact from the engineering up to the customer service and maintenance 4.0, so across the full life cycle. And as I was saying, it is not just about talking projects, it's about providing evidence that with the use of common data spaces, the whole industry, big players, small players in the engineering, in the commissioning, in the manufacturing, in the internal logistics, in the customer service, in the maintenance arena, all of them, they can actually deliver new processes with business impact. If people is interested to understand in more detail how predictive or forecasting can help companies to optimize warehouses and spare part management, or how the manufacturing processes can be improved in the shop floor, how can we increase the availability of our equipment in the shop floor, how we can reduce the time of engineering highly customized and high performance production lines, improve the quality control and the zero defect manufacturing of our products, or really optimize the commissioning of complex intralogistics and highly automated processes, I would invite the people interested to join the website on the Digital Factory Alliance, and under the European Lighthouse Network section, you will have individual explanations about how IDSA technology and how big data has actually transformed and impacted very big players in very diverse manufacturing sectors.
Thank you, Oscar. Thank you for this last explanation. So the time is over. First of all, thank you very much to you both to discussing and debating and sharing insights with us. I want to announce three more topics. First, there have been some questions in the chat. For those who are going a little bit deeper, I saw that there's one on security issues. Please relate or align and connect to my colleagues from the architecture and technology team. So Silvia Castelvi is in the call, but you can also just send an email to the info address or arrange a meeting with my colleagues, Silvia, Anil, or Sebastian Steinbus, our CTO. Also, we want to announce that there will be further editions of the Data Spaces Dialogue. The next one is at April 28. And it will be on rule books, success factors for data spaces. Then I want to already announce that the Hannover Messe, even though it will be a digital edition this year, IDSA will be involved in it. So keep an eye on this. And finally, for all of you who are interested in learning more about the use cases, about sovereign data sharing topics in various domains, please already reserve and block June 22 and 23, because there the annual IDSA summit will take place, most probably a full digital edition this year as well, but nobody knows during these days, but already the date is reserved. So please stay tuned. Thank you very much for your attendance, and I wish all of you a great day. Thank you and goodbye. Stay safe and healthy. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.